So now it seems like we have all the tools we need to actually stitch images together to create a panorama. So let's assume you have a set of images. You choose a reference image. You're going to compute the homography between that image and each of the other images. And now that gives you the geometric transformation that you need to warp each one of these images into the coordinate frame of your reference image. Now you have aligned images, and you somehow merge these images together to create a single image. Turns out that there are a few technical issues here that one needs to address in order to ensure that the final output is going to be of high quality. The first one is related to applying your geometric transformation, or what we call warping. So let's say that there's an image F here, and you want to apply a transformation, geometric transformation T to it, to get your transformed image G right here. So F transformed is G. This seems pretty straightforward. It seems like you can just go to each pixel in F, apply the transformation T, you know where you land in G, and write the brightness value or color at that location. Turns out there's a bit of a problem here. Imagine how this is implemented. In this case, you have a grid here for F, and you have a grid for G, and let's say that these are three pixels in F that you want to transform. So you do that, and you get these three locations right here. By looking at this, you see that there are two problems here. One is a pixel after being transformed may not land exactly at the center of a pixel in G. That may be a problem that we can resolve, but we'll have to deal with it. We might just assign its brightness value to perhaps the closest neighbor. The bigger problem is that once you're done with this, you could end up with pixels in G that do not actually end up getting filled. That is, you can end up with holes in G, and that's not a good thing. So how do we solve this problem? We do it by using not the forward warping, but the backward warping. So this is how it works. First, we take our image F, we look at the four corners of F, and we apply the forward warp to the four corners, the forward transformation using T to the four corners. That gives you the four corners of G. So that gives you the bounding box, if you will, for G. And now we're going to create an image representation for G where you have cells within that bounding box. Your goal now is to fill all those cells. So what you do is you take pixels in that cell, let's say these three pixels right here, and this time you're going to apply the inverse of the warp, that is the inverse of the transformation to these pixel locations, and you land at these three pixels. So now, of course, again, you could land at a point that is not the center of a pixel in F. That's okay. Once again, you can go and borrow your brightness value from your nearest neighbor, or you could use interpolation, which basically means that you will take a window around this point and then use all the brightness values within that window to figure out what the best estimate for the brightness here is. That's interpolation. So you've solved both problems here. First, you can interpolate to get better estimates of the brightness you want to write at a pixel in G. And secondly, by using the backward warping, you're going to ensure that you're not going to have any holes in G. So with that in place, we are now ready to do image alignment. Let's take this simple scenario here where you have three images, one, two, and three. We'll just decide that image two is going to be our reference image, meaning to say that that's the image to which we're going to warp all the other images. So now you take the corners of image one and image two, and we know the homography that takes you from image one to image two. So we take the corners of image one, and we're going to forward map them, and we get the bounding box for image one in the reference frame of image two. Do the same thing for image three. So these are the areas that we want to fill in, all of these pixels in here, even in the overlap region. So that's easy now. We take each pixel within the bounding box, and you essentially apply the backward map, H21, the backward warp, to go in and see where you land in image one, and you're going to go and pick the brightness value from there, either using interpolation or nearest neighbors, come back and write it at this location. Repeat it for all the pixels within your bounding box, and you get the image one now warped or transformed into the reference frame for image two. And the same applies to image three. So now you have these aligned images, and you're literally stacking them one on top of each other. Now, what happens if you just look at these stacked images? Essentially, you write one image, and then you overwrite another image on top of it, and so on and so forth. Well, you're going to get an image that is a panorama, but it looks like this. What you're seeing here is that you see these very clearly visible seams. So where do these seams come from? Well, firstly, when you're capturing these images, there's no reason to believe that the exposure of the camera is exactly the same between the two images. For that matter, even the lighting, as you're moving the camera, could change somewhat. It's possible that perhaps a sun just is passing through a cloud. And so therefore, you could have slight changes in the exposure of the scene, even though the images are being taken in quick succession. That's problem number one, the exposure problem or the illumination problem. The other problem, which is a real problem, is that we know from our lecture on image formation that the brightness response of a lens sort of falls off towards the periphery. And that's because of things like vignetting. So a point is brighter closer to the optical axis than it is when it gets to the periphery. And therefore, that's another reason why you may have a mismatch in brightness when you get close to an edge of an image right here. So we need some way of mitigating this issue, the radiometric or photometric differences between these images, so that we can somehow transition from one image to the other more seamlessly. So one way that you might imagine doing this is say, well, we have a stack of images. Why don't we just find the average of these images? So at each pixel, you see how many images you have at your disposal at that pixel. Take the average of all those brightness values. But that does a little bit better, but you see that these seams are still pretty clearly visible right here. And this is something that I want to bring to your attention, that when it comes to something as clean and structured as a line, say for instance, in an image, it turns out that the human visual system is extremely sensitive to brightness changes. It can pick up even brightness changes across a line like this of one gray level. It's extremely, extremely sensitive, and therefore it can perceive all of these artifacts very easily. So you want to actually do better than this. So that brings us to the problem of blending images. So how do you blend two images? So let's say you have two images here, I1 and I2, and let's say you want to blend these two images exactly at the center. You want the left half of your output image to be from I1 and the right half from I2. We know how to do that. We can actually either just cut and paste these halves, or you can use something like a weighting function that goes from 1 to 0 at the center for this image, 0 to 1 at the center for this image. You multiply W1 with image 1, W2 with image 2, and you add the two, you get this result right here, not surprising. And you can see that you get a very hard seam right here. It's clear that this is the concatenation of two images. But this idea of weighting can get you pretty far. For instance, if you used a smoother weighting function that gradually goes from 1 to 0 in the case of image 1, and from 0 to 1 in the case of image 2, and you use a blending equation which simply says the brightness in the blended image is W1 times I1 plus W2 times I2 divided by W1 plus W2, then you get an image that looks like this. And this is an interesting result, in that if I hadn't told you that this is the combination of two images or the blending of two images, it almost might seem to you like this is a plausible image without any blending going on, without any seams in it. So let's now see how we can apply this simple idea to our problem of stitching. Here you have three images, I1, I2, and I3. For each one, we are going to compute a weighting function of the type that we'd mentioned. So let's take image one right here. And the weighting function we're going to use is basically the following, that the weight that you assign to a pixel is going to be a function of the distance of that pixel from the closest boundary point. You can compute that by using the distance transform. There are many functions even in MATLAB that you can use to compute that. So the weight increases as your distance from the edge increases. The more you are inside an image, the more confidence we have in your brightness in the process of blending. So that simple weighting function allows you to take these three images which previously produced these seams, and when you blend using that function, you get a panorama that looks fairly seamless. Looks like a contiguous image with no artifacts, and that's exactly what you want. So we'll leave you with one last example. Pictures taken of the Notre Dame in Paris, and after you compute all the homographies, you see the images warped and aligned, and then after you blend them, you get this picture right here.